سيدي الأعزاء، أعزائي المستمعين، سيداتي وساداتي، نبدأ الجلسة الثانية بعنوان مقاطع تاريخية من العلاقات التركية السودانية. في هذه الجلسة سوف نستمع إلى مدرسينا القيمين الأربعة. الآن أترك الكلمة إلى المتحدث الأول، الأستاذ المحترم زكريا كرشون. تفضل أستاذي.
شكرا سعادة رئيس الجلسة. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أسعد الله أوقاتكم أيها الأعزاء والأحباء، كل من السودان وتركيا. أحييكم من صيف إسطنبول الممطر الجميل، وأتمنى لقاء مفيد إن شاء الله، وأتمنى أيضا من الله تعالى أن نخرج من هذه الأزمة، وإن شاء الله نعمل لقاءاتنا وجها لوجه. كلمتي ليس في العلاقات التركية السودانية، ولكن بل في تفسير العلاقات أو تفسير التاريخ، أو بكلمة أخرى تفسير العلوم الاجتماعية. أنا سوف أتحدث عن ثلاثة محاور إذا أستطيع، طبعا على حسب الوقت. المحور الأول ستكون عن دور العلوم الاجتماعية، وعلى رأسهم علم التاريخ في التقارب بين الدول الإسلامية، وكيف نستخدم مصادرنا المشتركة، على رأسهم مصادر التاريخ أو مصادر التركية أو الأرشيفات التركية، وأيضا كيف نفسر المصطلحات، أو كيف نخلق أو نجد مصطلحات جديدة لأن نفسر تاريخنا المشترك. كما نعلم جميعا إن تصنيف العلوم تقليد وعادة قديمة. كانت هذه العادة القديمة الممتدة من أرسطو إلى المفكرين الإسلاميين في العصور الوسطى، ومن الغزالي إلى الفلاسفة الأوروبيين في العصر الحديث. تهدف إلى تصنيف العلوم بشكل عام طبقا لخصائصها العلمية والنظرية، ولكنها بدأت تصنف على حسب توصيفها العلمي اعتبارا من القرن السادس عشر، فسميت علوم الكيمياء والفيزياء والإحياء باسم العلوم الطبيعة أو طبيعية، وسميت علوم التاريخ والاجتماع والاقتصاد، وطبعا متأخرا علم الأجناس باسم العلوم الاجتماعية. وتم هذا الشكل من التصنيف في إطار التيارات الفلسفية الحديثة التي تقدمت في الغرب من ناحية، وأساليب البحث المستخدمة من ناحية أخرى. وإصطلاح العلوم الاجتماعية هو اسم تلك العلوم الحديثة التي اكتشفتها الغرب حقيقيا، وهي تعتبر حلقة فاصلة عن العصور الوسطى، أو بتعبير آخر، طبعا على حسب تفسيراتهم، أو بتعبير آخر هو الاسم المطلق على النتائج المستنبطة لإدراك حقيقة الأحداث بعيدا عن إطار العلوم الدينية وعلوم ما وراء الطبيعة والأخلاق والمنطق واللغة، وذلك للقضاء على سيطرة الكنيسة على العلوم، والتي استمرت عدة قرون في الغرب. فهذه النقطة مهمة جدا. ومن ثم أطلق اسم العلوم الحديثة أو النظريات الحديثة على هذا المفهوم في الغرب، ولهذا كان هناك اعتقاد ساد لعدة قرون، بل وحتى إلى يومنا هذا، بأن الخارجين عن هذه النظريات التي باتت معتادة عند الغربيين لم يتخلصوا من الأفكار العصور الوسطى، وأنهم رجعيون يرفضون التحديث، وكثير من الأحيان نحن نتقابل بهذه الآراء في مقابلتنا العلمية. استخدم الغرب العلوم الاجتماعية لسنوات طويلة لتأسيس أنفسهم من جديد، واكتسبت هذه الحركة التي بدأت في القرن السادس عشر سرعة فائقة، خاصة في النصف الثاني من القرن التاسع عشر. وقد اعترفت الجامعات الغربية بإمكانيات استخدام مناهج العلوم الطبيعية لتطوير العلوم الاجتماعية، وبهذا تمكنت المجتمعات الغربية التي كانت تعيش حالة من الانقسام السياسي والاجتماعي لأسباب المختلفة، وتاريخ أوروبا معروفة عند كلنا، من الاتحاد، ووصلت إلى ما هي عليه الآن. يعني كانت حالة التفرق والتمزق، ولكن الآن لما نرى الغرب أنهم وصلوا إلى حالة الاتحاد. وكان طبعا يعني أنا قصدي النجاحهم في هذا هو مستند على تصنيف العلوم، أو ممكن نقول على تفسير العلوم الاجتماعية. وكان علم التاريخ الأسبق بالأخص في هذا الموضوع، فلم يعد علم التاريخ يقتصر على كونه علما ينقل أخبار الملوك ويظهرهم على حق وحسب، بل طوروه وأضفوا عليه مفاهيم حديثة. وبذلك أصبح علم التاريخ يعمل على تفسير الحاضر والإعداد للمستقبل من خلال الأبحاث الوثائقية المختلفة، وتم تحليل وتفسير المجالات الأخرى للعلوم الاجتماعية من جديد بشكل يساعد على نشر تلك النظرية وهذا التقريب الحديث. طبعا يعني هذا المنهج أو هذا أو التاريخ أصبحت وسيلة للتقرب بين الأمم الغربية. ونحن مع الأسف بعدما أسسنا مراكز مختلفة في البلدان الإسلامية توجهنا إلى العكس. وبظهور هذا التطور تم التمكن من نتيجة التخلص أو إبعاد من يسعون لتوضيح تحليلاتهم من خلال العلوم الدينية وعلوم ما وراء الطبيعة جانبا، ومن اتهموا بابتعادهم عن العلوم المثبتة أو الصحيحة. وبالرغم من أن علم التاريخ يستخدم عادة لتوضيح السياسات المستقبلية، وموضوعنا اليوم أصلا ليست نقاش التاريخ أو نقاش الماضي أو ذكر الأخبار القديمة، بالعكس نحن نريد أن نؤسس العلاقات على التاريخنا المشتركة. إلا أن الغربيين لم يكونوا منصفين في هذا، واتبعوا أسلوبا مرائيا يعني في تفسير التاريخ أو في تكوين التاريخ. عندنا تناولهم للتاريخ فقط اتفقوا على أن التاريخ هو التاريخ اليونان القديم وأنه مصدر التطورات، وبنوا تاريخهم على تلك النظرية. وعندما اتجهوا إلى الحضارات العالمية أو الحضارات الشرقية بصفة خاصة لم ينظروا إليها على أنها كل لا يتجزأ، بل نظروا إليها ودرسوها على أنها تاريخ أقوام وقبائل وجماعات متفرقة، أي جماعات غير متمدنة. وهذه النقطة مهمة أيضا يمكننا أن نناقش عليها، ويجب علينا أن نفكر فيها، لأن خاصة في خلال 100 سنة أو 150 سنة أو أكثر شوية بعد بداية تأسيس دول أو دويلات، أو ممكن نقول بعد انهيار الدولة العثمانية، أن هناك أصبح مراكز كثيرة، والغرب بدأ تدرس أو تبحث عن هذه المراكز، عن قصدي في الشرق في البلدان الإسلامية، وبدأوا يفسرون التاريخ هنا ليست تاريخ الكلي، بالعكس تاريخ متمزق، ويتحدثون عن الأجزاء، بينما هم لما يتحدثون عن التاريخ يرجعون إلى التاريخ القديم، ونحن لا ننكر طبعا التاريخ القديم اليوناني أو مصر أو إلى آخره، ولكن هم يرجعون إليه ويتخذونه وسيلة للاتحاد، وبنفس المنهج يعلموننا أن نمزق التاريخ. ومن هنا ممكن نقول، يعني أنا لا أريد أن أطول في هذا الكلام، ولكن ممكن نقول أن تاريخنا المشترك هو تاريخ الإسلامي. ولما نتحدث ونرجع إلى الوراء إلى تاريخ الإسلام ككل، نجد هناك فترات زمنية مختلفة، وأن تاريخ الدولة العثمانية تعادل تقريبا نصف التاريخ الإسلامي، يعني 600 سنة وشوية. ولا يمكن أن نبتعد تاريخ الدولة العثمانية من ضمن التاريخ الإسلامي. ولما نشوف المفردات أو الكتابات حتى أو المؤسسات العلمية وأقسام تاريخ في العالم الإسلامي، هناك قسم تاريخ الإسلامي كل بلد من بلدان الإسلام يأخذ فترة زمنية من تاريخ الإسلام ويبتعد أو يترك تاريخ الدولة العثمانية. ولما نشوف في تركيا أيضا، حتى في العلوم الإسلامية هم أيضا يقلدون نفس النظام، ولكن في الأقسام التاريخ تجد هناك تاريخ الإسلام شوية مهملة، ويكبرون في تاريخ الدولة العثمانية. وهذه من أكبر الخطأ الذين نحن وقعنا فيها، لأن تاريخ الإسلام هو تاريخ واحد، جزء لا يتجزأ. وطبعا لما نرجع إلى تاريخ الإسلام ككل، ممكن نجد هناك إيجابيات وسلبيات، فيمكن أن نناقش الإيجابيات والسلبيات. يعني لما نتحدث عن فترة الأمويين أو العباسيين أو بما ما بعدهم، هناك إيجابيات وسلبيات. وأيضا في تاريخ الدولة العثمانية يجب علينا أن نركز على الإيجابيات والسلبيات. طبعا المشكلة هي عدم استخدام المصادر المشتركة. يعني خاصة الدول الإسلامية في المشرق العربي وفي المغرب العربي خاصة تعتبر جديدة، وكلهم أسسوا مركز خاص، يعني كل العاصمة لها رؤية خاصة في التاريخ، وبحقهم طبعا أن يبدو تاريخهم. ولكن لا ننسى أن تاريخنا هو ما كان التاريخ ممزقة. صحيح أن الدويلات الآن أصبحت دويلات مختلفة، ولكن إذا أسست التاريخ على حسب الدولة الوحيدة وإنكرت قمت بإنكار التاريخ الثاني، معناها هذه يرجع إلى الحقد أو المنهج الأوروبي. يعني هم يوحدون تاريخهم ويمزقون تاريخنا، ويجب علينا أيضا نحن أن نرجع إلى تاريخنا الأساسي بهذه الطريقة. طبعا هناك مشاكل كثيرة في بناء هذا المفهوم الجديد. المشكلة الأولى يعني أن الدول القومية دائما أو الدولة القومية دائما يستند على تاريخه الخاص، والتاريخ هو وسيلة لبناء الدولة. طيب هل يمنعنا أن نعتمد على مثلا فترة زمنية من الفترات التاريخية ونترك الباقي؟ لا يجوز. نحن نعيش في أناضول في تركيا، وإذا أخذنا تاريخنا أو أبدأنا تاريخنا من الفترة الجمهورية الحديثة، هذا خطأ جدا ولا يمكن أن نصل إلى الحقيقة. ونفس الشيء يعني إذا أخذنا مثال من دولة السودان، الدولة السودان مش دولة جديدة. صحيح أن أسست الدولة الحديثة في السنة 1956، ولكن لما نرجع إلى الفترات القديمة هناك نجد يعني إما في بلاد السودان ككلها أو في الشرق بلاد السودان أيضا هناك دول مختلفة قبل الإسلام وبعد الإسلام، ولا يمكن واحد أن يبدأ من 1956. ولذا يجب علينا أن نرجع ونقرأ تاريخنا المشترك من جديد بمفاهيم جديدة. طبعا هناك المشكلة في المصطلحات المستخدمة بين المؤرخين العرب والأتراك. على سبيل المثال في الصبح أنا كنت أتابع المؤتمر وسمعت من سعادة السفير أيضا، هو يقول أن بعض المفردات الموجودة في كتب المقررة في السودان يتحدث عن بعض المصطلحات ويجب علينا أن نصحح هذه الأخطاء، ولكن نفس الشيء أصلا موجودة في كل البلدان العربية والتركية أيضا. نحن نحب مثلا في تركيا كلمة الغازي، وعندنا كلمات غزارات موجودة وهو مطلوبة ومرغوبة، ولكن الغزوة تختلف عندنا معنى الغزوة، ولكن عندكم في السودان هناك في الكتابات تكتب غزوة العثمانيين مثلا. إذن يجب علينا أن نفسر هذا الموضوع، ما هو الغزوة والغزوات وما في الفرق بين الإغارة والغزوة. وأيضا هناك كلمات أخرى والمصطلحات أخرى مثل الاستعمار، نحن نستخدم كلمة استعمار في تاريخ اللي ما كانت المستعمرين أصلا، يعني هناك في القرن السادس عشر لما نتحدث عن الاستعمار حتى في الغرب أيضا ربما تحتاج تفسير، ولكن كلمة استعمار، كلمة احتلال، كلمة نفوذ والتأثير والحكم، كل هذه المصطلحات تحتاج تفسيرها من جديد حتى نجلس ونخلق تاريخ جديد. خلاصة أنا على حسب الوقت أنا لن أتحدث عن الأرشيفات الموجودة عندنا، ولكن المشكلة هي المشكلة الأساسية هي أن الباحثين العرب رغم بدأوا يستخدمون الأرشيفات العثمانية في الفترة الأخيرة لا يعرفون النظام الموجود فيها جيد جدا، وأن الأتراك أيضا لا يستخدمون المصادر المحلية، وهذه أيضا نقص كبير في فهم أو إعادة كتابة التاريخ المشترك. أن الاستخدام وثيقة أو استخدام المصدر بنفسها في التاريخ تحتاج مهارة خاصة، ليست الوثيقة العثمانية فقط. على سبيل المثال يعني لما تأخذ الوثيقة، وأنا أعرف دكتور عمر هو شاف هذه الوثائق كثيرة عن السيد المهدي، الوثيقة الإنجليزية، تجد هناك رجل موصوف بطريقة غير عادية، ولما تجد نفس الشيء في نفس الفترة الوثيقة مثلا عن أفريقيا أو عن المنطقة تجد وصفه بشخص آخر. إذن ليست المشكلة في الوثائق العثمانية فقط، بل في استخدام الوثائق كلها. يجب علينا أيضا أن نؤسس مؤسسات علمية أو نؤسس بعض الدورات لتكوين القدرات كيفية الاستخدام المصادرنا المشترك. ولا يمكن أنني أقول أن المصادر المحلية السودانية ليست مصادر تركية، وأن السوداني لا يمكن أن يقول أن المصادر العثمانية ليست مصادر سودانية ليس لها أي أهمية. هناك مشكلة في أيضا في في في في الأبحاث الحالية، مثلا الباحث لما يذهب إلى الأرشيفات العالمية في تركيا أو في أوروبا يبحث عن بعض الكلمات keywords مثلا، يبحث عن تركيا أو عن السودان، وإذا وجد كلمة سودان يستمر إلى البحث، وإذا لم يجد كلمة سودان لا يستمر ويترك العمل. ولكن في النهاية أن السودان كانت في نفس الفترة موجودة، إذن لابد أن نفسر المعلومات العامة للسودان ولتركيا أيضا.
أستاذي العزيز دقيقة
انت
واحدة،
تمام تمام سأنهي إن شاء الله. ويجب علينا إعادة قراءة تاريخنا المشترك، إما باستخدام المناهج العلوم الاجتماعية أو إبداع المناهج خاصة لتاريخنا، ولا يجوز أن نمزق التاريخ، وأيضا لا يجوز أو المنهج التاريخي لا يقبل التاريخ على تاريخ، أو لا عندنا ضرب مثل تركي يقول أبي يضرب أبيك، الأولاد لما يتقابلون أبي يضرب أبيك، لا يجوز أن نقول بنفس الشيء تاريخي يضرب تاريخك أو تاريخي يتوافق تاريخك، هو تاريخ ويجب علينا أن نكون أصدقاء لحقائق تاريخية. وشكرا جزيلا لحسن استماعكم وصدر سعتكم سعادة صدركم.
شكرا جزيلا أستاذي زكريا كرشون على هذا العرض العميق والواسع الإطار. الآن أردت أن أعطي الكلمة لمتحدثنا الثاني. المتحدث الثاني هو الأستاذ المحترم سليمان كزل توبراك، وسيقدم عرضا بعنوان السودان على إثر الجغرافيا السياسية والتاريخية. من فضلكم يا أستاذ.
شكرا جزيلا يا رئيس الجلسة، و أريد أن أتكلم باللغة الإنجليزية بإذنك إن شاء الله. His Excellency our Ambassador, dear colleagues and dear friends who organized the meeting. I would like to present my presentation because I prepared about 10 pages, but I have to summarize now as much as possible. Sudan in the traces of geopolitics and history. Sudan, as the largest country in Africa after Algeria and Congo, and has a significant importance in the politics of the East African region and the African continent. Sudan draws attention in terms of its geopolitical position and resources in the Nile Basin, also has an ancient past. It has long centuries of cultural and civilizational relations with other countries in the Nile Basin, especially with Egypt, Eritrea, Djibouti, Chad, and Abyssinia, Ethiopia. It has also close relations with the Arabian Peninsula due to the coast of the Red Sea. Sudan, in the context of the African policy during the Ottoman state period, has a significant role in the Ottoman history. With the capture of Egypt in 1517, the Mamluk period there ended, and Turkish admirals Oruç, Hızır, and İshak brothers took Algeria from the Spanish in at the beginning of the 16th century and brought it under Ottoman rule, it was the continuation of the Muslim rule, which has lasted for centuries, but was threatened by the Spanish attacks. With the admission of Barbaros to the Ottoman service, Algeria came under Ottoman rule during 1520s. Then Tunisia and Tripoli in 1551. Thus began a new era in the history of Africa, especially in the history of North Africa. From the beginning of the 8th century until the first quarter of 19th century, I mean 1830s, in a sense, until today, North Africa became a part of the Eastern Mediterranean in a Muslim life, and Muslim life and thought under Arab and Berber and Turkish domination. The Ottoman Empire's expansion of Egypt had important consequences for the North Africa and for the East Africa. It became easier for the Ottomans stationed in Egypt to implement the policy of controlling the sea routes in the Mediterranean. In addition, Egypt's geostrategic position led the Ottomans to dominate the East African and North African region. The Ottoman Empire, which also assumed the influence of Egypt in the Hijaz, included Mecca and Medina, the holy cities of Islam, within its borders. Thus, the Ottoman state, Hadimul Haramain of holy cities, the servant of the holy cities, as the sultans of Ottoman state, gained a great prestige in the Islamic world. The Ottoman Empire's conquest of the region had important consequences for Western Asia and North Africa. It became easier for the Ottomans that stayed in Egypt to implement the policy of controlling the sea routes in the Mediterranean, also in the Red Sea region. In addition, Ottoman's geostrategic position in Egypt led the Ottomans to dominate the East African and North African countries. The Ottoman Empire, which also assumed the influence of Egypt in Hijaz. On the other hand, the settlement of the Ottoman Empire in Iraq also had an impact on the road to India. Istanbul, the capital of the Ottoman Empire, which took Iraq after Egypt, provided a strategic advantage by owning the Basra port and distribution. In the face of the Portuguese threat, it caused the Ottomans to organize naval expedition to the Red Sea to ensure the safety of the Indian route upon calls from India. In the face of the threat posed by the European powers' arrival in India by going around the Cape of Good, Cape of Good Hope, and going to the Indian Ocean, the Ottoman Empire began to struggle with these powers, both in the ocean and on the African continent. For this reason, during the reign of the Süleyman the Magnificent, the Indian campaign, the fourth Indian campaign, Abyssinia, Ethiopia or Habesh, Habesh, the province of Habesh was conquered, and the province of Habesh was established during the 16th century, the second period of the 16th century. Ottoman activities in the Red Sea began and developed when the Navy, which was preparing for Indian expedition, landed in the Suakin from Suez and established an advanced naval base there. Also, a new naval base was established in Massawa, in Zeyla, with the full control over the Red Sea region. The issues that were dealing with the Ottoman Empire in the in this region with the competition with the European powers didn't allow for new initiatives in this region, which were far from the center. The Ottoman Empire undertook the protection of the Islamic world against the Christian states in the eastern and west, eastern and western Mediterranean region. Thanks to the Ottoman Empire, thanks to the Turks, Algeria and North Africa were saved from a great disaster caused by Spain and Portugal. At the same time, the policy that Spain applied to the states in occupied in South Africa was a complete genocide. If Spain had succeeded in invading North Africa, starting with Algeria, there was a strong possibility that it would have done what it did in Andalusia and South America. In the three centuries under Ottoman rule, the future borders of Algerian state were determined and the tradition of administration began in this period. The same true, the same situation is true for Tunisia and Libya. And even though the Ottoman state unable to prevent Europeans from entering Africa, she settled in East Africa. I mean, today's Sudan and Ethiopia coast, and also Somalia, Eritrea, and Djibouti. Undoubtedly, the Ottoman Empire's dominance in Egypt played a major role in this development. I think I have 5 minutes. I would like to summarize, and I would like to focus on the importance of the independence movement in Sudan. in the independence movement, Sudan first emerged in 1881 as a religious rebellion in the south of Halfa Valley. Foreign intervention and pressure on the people in Sudan had reached the breaking point. The Mehdi movement in Sudan, like the Urabi movement in Egypt, according to Ottoman statesmen, a revolt against European intervention and sovereignty in the eyes of them. However, there is a remarkable point here. Sudan is under the sovereignty of Ottoman state, Ottoman Empire, depending on the administration of the Egypt, the Khedive of Egypt. The uprising in Sudan is a struggle against the Khedive of Egypt, rather than getting rid of Ottoman rule. The Ottoman state accept this situation. Abdülhamid also viewed the uprising in Sudan from his perspective. According to him, Sudan problem occurred because the British disrupted the order in Egypt, disrupted the order in the Red Sea. Without the administrative vacuum in Egypt, this problem wouldn't have arisen. Dear friends, unlike the Wahhabi movement in the Arabian Peninsula, the Sudanese Mehdist movement is not a threat to the Ottoman Empire. Muhammad Abdullah directly claimed that he was the anticipated savior of the Muslim in Sudan, although it targeted the Abdulhamid's policy of Islamic unity, it didn't pose as much ideological danger as Wahhabism for the Ottoman Empire. On the other hand, despite the British pressure to declare Urabi in Egypt and Mehdi a rebel in Sudan, the Ottoman sultans of the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire, I mean Abdülhamid II, avoided giving a positive response to this demand for a long time. For him, Mehdi and Urabi were accused of opposing the Khedive, not opposing the Sultan. Not the opposing the halife. Okay.
Dakikaten min fadlikum.
Okay. Şükran. Thus, the implicit support and legitimacy were given to the independence movement in the two countries. In the edicts, the fermans, in the fermans written on this subject, it was emphasized that the Sudanese people were under the umbrella of the caliphate. In short, fighting for independence against imperialist forces was not considered as a violation of the sovereignty right of the states. I would like to conclude. It is finally, I would like to say, I would like to focus on two countries, two nations relations. The relationships of Turkey's geography with Africa has been in all periods of history. The geography of the Middle East is a part of the African history. Today's problems stem to some extent from not understanding the history, that is, not understanding that Africa and the Middle East are indivisible geography. the Sudanese people who made revolutions in 1881 and 1956, resembling the awakening of the giant in the fairy tale, are trying to ensure peace and stability within themselves today. The steps taken by the Sudanese state in the direction of justice, human rights, peace, and prosperity make Turkey happy and Turkish nation happy today as it was yesterday. Lastly, after the Second World War, the African revolutions that took place in Tunisia, Algeria, Sudan, and Ghana were followed with the love and enthusiasm in Turkey. For example, Fethi Gemihloğlu wrote several articles applauding this revolution in a local newspaper in Malatya, in the east region of Turkey, in 1956. It celebrated the collapse of the British Empire by revolutionary movements in Africa. He noted that history will not forget the shameful massacres of the French imperialism oppressed against the Algeria for world. He said that it is our duty to state that we expect good and happy developments between Sudan and Turkey, and Africa needs to be addressed with foresight and attention and with a sensitive mindset. That is the synthesis of Fethi Gemihloğlu, one of the famous Turkish writer and philosopher. I would like to conclude with these sentences, and thank you very much for patience. Best regards.
أود أن أشكر أستاذ سليمان كزل توبرك على هذا العرض الجميل والواسع. الآن أود أن أعطي الكلمة لمتحدثنا الثالث. المتحدث الثالث لدينا دكتور عمر كوتشيت. يقدم عرضا بعنوان التيقظ ضد المهدي السوداني. استجواب تاجرين في الأراضي العثمانية. تفضل سيدي.
شكرا. My presentation is also in English. Thank you very much for your invitation. The speakers before me presented the general framework of the historical relationship between Sudan and Turkey. So I don't want to repeat the general information. And the period that I am interested in is the period between 1881-1888, known as the Mehdi period in the literature. So in my presentation, I want to talk to you about two detailed events that took place during the Mehdi revolt. As mentioned before me, the Sudanese Mehdi Rebellion is a turning point in the history of Sudan, which affected the shape of the modern Sudan. This rebellion was started by a Sufi sheikh, Muhammad Ahmed ibn Abdullah, a charismatic religious leader who pronounced himself as the expected Mehdi and played a crucial role in the political and social future of the Sudan. However, his uprising was not only related to the administrations of the Sudanese region, but also the surrounding countries, as well as the British and Ottoman empires. Becoming aware of the Mehdi rebellion in Sudan, Ottoman statesmen took various measures to protect their territories from the influence of the Mehdi movement. One of the most important places was the Hijaz, Mecca and Medina. Because if the Sudanese Mehdi became influential in this holy place, the Ottoman Empire would lose its religious leadership, which it was struggling to consolidate as a matter of state policy known as Pan-Islamism during the reign of Sultan Abdulhamid II. Besides this, the other parts of the empire, especially the capital city, Istanbul, were also kept on guard against the force of distant ideas to the state. In this regard, my presentation will show two detailed interrogation texts of two merchants who came from Sudanese region to Ottoman territories. One of them, Hafiz Mahmud, was questioned on suspicion of being the Caliph of the Mehdi in Istanbul in 1884, and the other, Sherif Muhammad el-Medeni in Mecca in 1888. As you know, the Sudan was directly across the Red Sea from the Hijaz, and there were many Hijazi merchants who traded with the Sudan regularly. And my first example is from these Hijazi merchants. In 1888, according to an archival document in the Ottoman archives, we see that the Hijazi merchant Sherif Muhammad ibn Abdullah el-Medeni was questioned in Mecca by Ottoman officers. This person, who worked in Sudan 15 years, came back to Mecca, and the Ottoman police and statesmen questioned him and then sent the text in the Ottoman Empire. We see, we know this text as Istintakname, to Istanbul. And during this time, the governor of Hijaz was Saffet Pasha. The police asked questions about the Sudanese Mehdi, the reason for the uprising, the purpose of Muhammad Ahmed, the movement's leader after the death of the Mehdi, and the weapons and manpower of the movement. Sherif Muhammad says that the purpose of Muhammad Ahmed was to take Sudan under complete control, then Egypt, then to take Hijaz, and so became the expected Mehdi, Mehdi al-Muntazar. He also mentioned Caliph Abdullah, whose aim, he said, was to take Egypt and Hijaz like his predecessor, the Mehdi. Likely, there is some information regarding the general situations of the movement. In the report, which was sent in the same folder with the query text to Istanbul, Saffet Pasha says that Sherif Pasha was called and questioned because he might know the exact reason for the uprising and also about the beginning and result of the Sudanese rebellion. So this query text was supplied to the Sublime State. This was a short text, but the other one is more detailed one. The other merchant who I want to mention is Hafiz Mahmud Efendi. Hafiz Mahmud Efendi was originally from Aleppo and had lived in Zanzibar. He had also come to Istanbul several times to sell products from the African territories. He is introduced as dark-faced, medium-sized, slim, with a short beard, and as belonging to the Qadiriyya sect. He was 35 years old and had also been to Sudan, Alexandria, Egypt, Yemen, and Hijaz frequently in a 21-year-long trading career. In his last arrival in Istanbul, his aim was to sell 200 sacks of coconuts, which he had transported from Zanzibar by steamship several months before he took to the road. After he had sent the coconuts, he came to Istanbul by the Red Sea Road. When he arrived in Istanbul, he was disappointed to find that the coconuts has decomposed while being held at the quarantine station at Alexandrian port. This unexpected state of affairs caused him significant trade losses, and he earned less money than he had originally hoped. To gain back some profits, he bought some products like umbrellas by spending 300 Turkish liras in Istanbul. Hafiz Mahmud was questioned via the interpreter of Mehmet Abdi Efendi, the relative of Hafiz Mahmud. His statements last 9 pages in the Ottoman archives. It is understood from the questions of the police officers in charge of his interrogation that they sought to find out his aim in coming to Istanbul and whether or not he was an admirer of the Sudanese Mehdi. Since he was able to sell coconuts and buy items like umbrellas in Alexandria, the officer was suspicious of him. When he was in Istanbul, Hafız Mahmud Efendi, according to this istintakname, he had met a doctor whose name was Cerrah Mehmet Efendi. The officer wanted to learn something about Mehmet Efendi, as it appeared possible that he was the known suspect. When Hafız Mahmud said the name of Cerrah Mehmet, the officer asked what they had talked about when he had stayed for 3 days during the month of Ramadan in his home in Aksaray. More importantly, he asked whether Cerrah Mehmet Efendi wanted to travel anywhere in particular with Hafız Mahmud. Cerrah Mehmet Efendi had talked about the events in Sudan and had spoken about going to Sudan to work as a doctor. However, he had not requested help with travel from Hafız Mahmud, but only asked about the circumstances of Sudan. The police officer in Istanbul wanted to learn where Cerrah Mehmet planned to go and whether it was to the Mehdi under the pretext of work or not. Hafız Mahmud said that Cerrah Mehmet had no specific intention to go to Mehdi, but simply planned to go to Sudan. But in the same folder, we see that Hafız Mahmud mentions about the Sudanese Mehdi in detail. He says that Mehdi's name as Muhammad bin Ahmed and described him as a tall, black bearded man who wore a white turban upon being asked the officer about the name and appearance of the Mehdi. He stated that he heard the Mehdi belonged to Qadiriyya sect and that he had visited him in his dervish lodge 4 years previously. And there was no sign of rebellion then. The soldiers of the Mehdi were from Sudan and Egypt, but he didn't hear anything about their guns, about which the police officers wanted to learn. The officer asked how a person who wanted to arrive at the Mehdi's place could go there. There was possible, Hafız Mahmud answered, with commercial aims and roads, but it was not easy as before. In the statement of Hafız Mahmud also, we see that Hafız Mahmud says he belonged to Sultan Abdülhamid II, who was the Sultan and Caliph of the whole earth, Halife-i Ruh-i Zemin, and that if the state would order to him to go to the Mehdi, then he could go there secretly. If, on the other hand, it were not necessary, he would simply go to Zanzibar via Egypt. One day after this inquiry, we understand from the same folder, on 1 August 1884, Cerrah Mehmet Efendi was also questioned by the police officer in Istanbul. On the same day, after the Cerrah Mehmet was questioned, Hafız Mahmud was brought back for interrogation because of the conflicted information regarding the former's plans to go to Sudan. In the official report which was written one day after the inquiries had taken place, it is said that Hafız Mahmud Efendi was neither the Caliph of the Mehdi nor posed any danger. On the other hand, it is important to note that Ottoman authorities took precautions to prevent the Mehdi movement from spreading to other cities, especially Istanbul. These two stories, which I have tried to present in detail, show us that even a rumor or a complaint was not ignored, but examined in detail by Ottoman officers in Istanbul or in Hijaz. Besides this, Ottoman common people were aware of the Mehdi and were interested in him. The Ottoman rulers were also aware of the possibility of a relationship between the Mehdi and some people in Istanbul. The merchants could play a significant role in fostering such a connection. Trade attached importance to intercultural interaction between Sudan and Istanbul, and Istanbul was one of the busy centers of trade. Hence, care was taken so as to ensure that the Sudanese Mehdi rebellion was not to allowed to have influence in the Ottoman cities. The Ottoman Empire struggled to protect its territories, especially Istanbul and Hijaz, from the influence of the Sudanese Mehdi, took many measures to safeguard the territories, and obtained detailed information about the developments in Sudan, not only from the official reports, but also from merchants who came from the region to the Ottoman territories. Thank you.
Şükran cezilen, Üstazi el-Kerim, for this على هذا العرض الجميل ولاستكماله في الوقت المحدد الآن وأخيرا الأستاذ مصطفى تشبوك سيقدم عرضا بعنوان نشاطات العثمانيين في السودان خلال الحرب العالمية الأولى ها أنت يا أستاذي العزيز
Assalamu alaikum. Greetings from Kahramanmaraş. Before I begin my speech, I greet you all with respect and love. My presentation in English, my topic is about Ottoman activities in Sudan during the World War I. Firstly, I will speak about the Ottoman city's jihad policy during the World War I. In the First World War, the Ottoman state mobilized all its material and spiritual resources and declared jihad in order to include the Muslims living in the Ottoman lands and different geographies in the war, or at least to prevent them from helping the enemy countries. Declaration of jihad was a method traditionally used by Islamic states. With the declaration of jihad, it was shown to Muslims that war was legitimate in terms of Islamic law. And it was tried to get their support by appealing to the religious feelings of Muslims. It was aimed to benefit from the spiritual influence of the caliphate in the Islamic world. With the declaration of jihad, it was aimed that the Muslims of the world rise against the colonialist states. Jihad fatwas were sent to Muslim communities living in different parts of the world. One of the places where these fatwas were sent was Sudan. In addition to jihad fatwa, the Ottoman Sultan Mehmet Reşat, the commander of in chief of the Ottoman armies, Enver Paşa, and the Ottoman Şeyhül İslam Mustafa Hayri Efendi also sent letters inviting Muslims to join the Jihad-ı Ekber. In these letters, it was stated that the Caliph, as Emir al-Mu'minin, means the leader of the Muslims, declared jihad against the enemy and that Muslims should comply with this call. In the jihad fatwa, it was emphasized that Muslims should resort to jihad with their lives and property against the enemy attack to the religion of Islam and Islamic countries, which is an order that must be fulfilled. In the fatwa, which warns that Muslims who oppose jihad will be sinful, it was aimed to revolt the Muslims who were under the captivity of allied powers against these states. Before the First World War, it was seen that the call for jihad against the colonial powers in Algeria, Sudan, Libya was effective and that the colonial powers suffered many casualties despite their superiority as weapons against the local resistance forces. The Mehdi Wamud, as you know, which declared jihad against the British in Sudan in 1896, was the most effective and successful local resistance movement against foreign occupation in the 19th century. With the support of the Ottoman state, the Germans wanted to organize resistance movements and against the British in Egypt, in India, in Algeria, in Sudan and Libya. They wondered why jihad, which worked in Libya and Algeria, should not be used in Egypt and India. During their African travels, the Germans saw the role of Islam as an ideology in organizing local resistances. Şeyhul İslam Mustafa Hayri Efendi also sent a letter of invitation to the Sudanese Muslims during the World War First, I would like to talk about the content of this letter. Can I share this letter? I obtained this letter from Imperial War Museum in England when I was in England. Share.
You can do it now, please.
Thank you very much. The jihad letter sent by Sheikhul Islam Mustafa Hayri Efendi to the Sudanese Muslims. The letter was written by Sheikhul Islam in Arabic in the form of fatwa. The letter was written in a question and answer style, and as if it were a conversation. In the letter, he explained against whom and why Muslims should fight, with references to the verses, the decisions of ulama, and the Jihad-i Ekber fatwa, which was published in Istanbul right after the war started. It is understood that the letter was written in April 1915. In the letter, Sheikhul Islam said that Russian, French, and British attacked and massacred Muslims. He called on the Muslim communities and warned them not to give food, water, animals, or anything to these countries. He declared that God would punish those who supported the French, British, and Russians. In the letter addressed to the ulama, I ordered you jihad because that is how God wants it. After saying that, he warned not to prevent those who help Muslims and support them. He stated that he would send the letter to the Sudanese community so that everyone would understand what happened between the Muslims and the infidels, and that he wanted to warn the Sudanese with this letter, addressing the Sudanese community in the letter, whoever fears Allah and his messenger does not support the unbelievers. He was warning the Sudanese by saying, Sheikhul Islam completed his letter with the following sentences. Whoever supported our nation supported Amir al-Mu'mineen. Whoever supported Amir al-Mu'mineen supported Islam. This is the order of to Amir al-Mu'mineen, don't give anything from your country to the French, English, and Russian, because they are the enemies of Allah and Muslims, Muslim communities. Don't obey the British, French, and Russians at this time, because this is the time of jihad, and don't forget the Sudanese Muslim community. I sent this letter to invite you to the jihad. That's it. Greetings. I also speak about the Ottoman's other activities in Sudan. During the war years, Sudan and Libya had a special importance for the Ottoman state. As they were geographically close to Egypt, as well as being places where Muslims lived intensively, Sudan and Libya were important targets in terms of operations to Egypt. Since Britain had very tight control in Egypt, it was very necessary for the Ottomans and Germany to acquire allies in the region close to Egypt. Starting from August 1914, Germany and Ottoman state began to send propaganda materials, agents, and money to the colonies of allied powers in Africa. When the declaration of split in Africa, Muslims in the African continent added anti-colonialism to the meaning of jihad. Thus, adding an anti-colonial tone to the meaning of jihad, African Muslims fought under difficult conditions to protect their homeland and to prevent imperial powers from training them like animals by enslaving them. They did not have any modern weapons and war equipment. They did not have a doctor to look after them when they were injured. Since the imperialist powers cooperated with each other, they prevented the people of the region from acquiring firearms. The Muslim insurgents in Africa were very weak against the imperialist powers in terms of military training and especially firearms. Since the local forces were generally equipped with medieval weapons such as arrows, spears, and swords, the imperialist powers won easy victories. Local powers were also unable to procure firearms and ammunition from other imperialist powers due to their agreements with each other. The only power could supply firearms to the Senussis, Ali Dinar, and other Muslim groups in Africa was the Ottoman state. Firearms were mostly delivered to North Africa, Sudan, Waday, Abyssinia, via Turkish ports such as Derne at Tobruk. On the other hand, the Ottoman state also gave military training some local Muslim groups such as Senussis through the officers it sent to the region. When the First World War started, some officers under the command of the Enver Pasha's brother Nuri Bey were sent to Egypt, Abyssinia, and Sudan. One of the duties of these officers was to ensure that the Muslims of the region participate in Jihad-e Ekber. The call for jihad quickly spread throughout Africa. However, the most willing support for the call for jihad came from the Sudanese Muslims. In Sudan, the British colonial administration bloodily suppressed the Mahdi revolt in 1906. And the atrocities committed by the British were still vivid in the memories of the Sudanese Muslims. Under the influence of this persecution, Sudanese Muslims embraced the call for jihad more tightly. At the same time, the Egyptian Khedive Abbas Hilmi Pasha also supported the Ottoman activities in Sudan during the First World War. When the Ottoman state entered the First World War on the side of Germany, England effectively ended Abbas Hilmi Pasha's Khedive of Egypt. Abbas Hilmi Pasha invited Muslims in Egypt and Sudan to join the jihad. The British colonial administration in Sudan declared that they found that undated booklets titled Circular from the Mouth of Egyptian Khedive Abbas Hilmi Pasha II were circulating. In the continuation of the circular, Abbas Hilmi Pasha reported that the British claimed to protect the Holy Lands by they dropped bombs on the Holy Lands. Many copies of the booklet were found in a bale of cotton by British colonial officials in the port of Sudan. The booklets were sent to be given to the Sudanese sheikhs. During the first channel operation, while the attacks of the Senussi in Egypt continued, the units under the command of Yunus Molla in Sudan attacked British military points and captured a large amount of supplies and ammunition. Upon the developments in Sudan, the British began to send troops to the region via the Red Sea Muslim Indian soldiers in the British Army, some Muslim Indian soldiers in the British Army, not wanting to fight the Muslims, rebelled and fled into Sudan. I want to talk about the other leader activities. Sudan Darfur Sultan Ali Dinar during the World War First and its relations with Ottoman state. During the war years, Seyyid İdris Senussi from the Senussi family was also carrying out propaganda activities for the benefit of the Ottoman state in Sudan. Enver Pasha asked İdris Senussi to persuade Ali Dinar, the Sultan of Darfur, to join the jihad because the orders of Ali Dinar were in demand in Sudan. Ali Dinar became the Sultan of Darfur in 1989. After he became the Sultan, he tried to solve the land problem and rebuild his country, which was devastated by anarchy. Darfur was at that time in Central Africa between the British and French colonial territories. The imperialist state did not want a local strong state in Africa. The British also wanted to abolish the Darfur Sultanate, which was the last independent Muslim state in Central Africa. Ali Dinar was also in effort to protect his sultanate and the Islamic lands under his rule against the invasion of Christian Europeans. Ali Dinar, who was aware of the intentions of the imperialist powers, tried to strengthen his relations with the Ottoman state, which was the only power that could provide him with the necessary protection. Ambassador Muhammad El Sheikh Simavi Efendi, who was sent to Hijaz by Sultan of Ali Dinar in 1909, applied to the governor of Hijaz and declared Sultan al-Dinar's loyalty to the Ottoman Sultan. Ambassador also demanded that an Ottoman flag be given to them to show that the Darfur Sultanate was under Ottoman rule. The most important mediator after the Hijaz who established the connection between Ali Dinar and Ottoman state was the Senussis. Sultan Ali Dinar wanted to strengthen his relations with the Senussis, both because of his thought about Islamic Union and because of the trouble he was in. Ottoman officers and officers of Ottoman intelligence service called as Teşkilat-ı Mahsusa made an effort to improve relations between Ali Dinar and Ahmet Senussi, the leader of the Senussis. The Ottoman state wanted the cooperation of two influential Islamic powers in the region. Deputy Commander-in-Chief of Ottoman armies, Enver Pasha, wrote a letter to Ali Dinar on 3 February 1915. In the letter, the attacks of Russia, England, and France on the Ottoman state and Islam were told. It was stated that the Ottoman Sultan, who was the Caliph of the Muslims, declared jihad in the face of these attacks against Islam. And it was emphasized that jihad was obligatory for every Muslims should side with the Caliph. The delegation sent to Ali Dinar with gifts by Ottoman Sultan and Caliph Sultan Reşit. Ali Dinar welcomed this delegation consisting of four people very well. During the Friday prior, he personally went to the sermon and announced the greetings of the Caliph and Enver Pashas to the prayer group. After introducing the Ottoman delegation to them, he informed them that the Holy War and the Salvation Islam were near and everyone should be ready for it. Ali Dinar also announced to his people that he was on the side of the Ottoman state and that they followed the order of jihad. Ali Dinar wrote the following in his reply letter to Enver Pasha. He said that I wanted to inform His Holiness the Caliph that as soon as this war started between His Holiness the Sultan of Islam and the British and French.
Professor Mustafa, 2 minutes, please.
2 minutes, okay. Who were infidels and heretics and their allies, I cut off relations with the infidels for the sake of Allah and Islam and declared them enemies and declared war on them. Ali Dinar's aim was to take Khartoum and liberate Sudan from British occupation. Ali Dinar declared full independence and refused to pay taxes to the British colonial administration in Khartoum on 22 April 1915. Afterwards, he declared jihad against the British and their French ally and sided with the Ottoman state. The possibility of Sudanese people and former Mehdi supporters supporting the Ottoman state against the imperialist power with the declaration of jihad and the possibility of Ali Dinar's move from the west towards Khartoum alarmed the British. The British colonial administration in Sudan feared that Ali Dinar would unite with the Senussi, a strong army and strong coastal organization would be required to deal with a force that would emerge as a result of the merger of the two Islamic forces. Colonial forces took action to prevent this from happening. Some weapons and ammunition had previously been sent to Ali Dinar from the Teşkilat-ı Mahsusa warehouse in Benghazi. However, the fact that the Ottoman forces had to fight defensively against the Dardanelles attack of the Entente states made it impossible to send weapons and materials to the Ali Dinar that would enable him to attack the British. In addition to Dardanelles attacks, the entry of Italy into the war on the side of Entente powers in May 1915 and the cooperation of Italy and England against the Senussis narrowed the Senussis' range of action in the region. The Ottoman Senussi alliance, which was at war with both France, England, and Italy at the same time could not support Ali Dinar enough. This situation put the Ali Dinar movement in a difficult position against the invaders. In 1916, Britain's Sudanese colonial administration attacked Ali Dinar's country with an army equipped with advanced weapons equipment, such as cannon batteries, motor vehicles, supported by the Egyptian colonial forces and 4 British warplanes. Despite their limited resources and simple weapons, Sultan Ali Dinar and his mujahideen resisted with all their means to defend their country.
There, Professor, we have passed our limit.
Okay, just a minute. Despite the deprivation, Sultan Ali Dinar army heroically resisted against British. At the end, he lost the war due to the superior weaponry of the colonial British forces, was martyred in the Battle of Jebel Juba on 6 November 1916. After the martyrdom of Ali Dinar, Sudanese people also maintained their struggle against the British colonial forces. As a conclusion, as in other Islamic societies, Sudanese Muslims generally regarded jihad invitation with sympathy. The Muslim communities living under the colony saw the declaration of jihad by the Ottoman state as a remedy for liberation from the colonial powers. Thank you very much for listening to me. Best regards.
Shukran jazilan li Ustaz Mustafa Chabuk ala hadha al ardh al jamil al muthir lil i'jab.
Thank you very much.
ننتقل الآن إلى جزء المناقشة وجزء السؤال والجواب. إذا كانت هناك أي تقديم مساهمة من الأساتذة الكرام أو أسئلة من مستمعين المحترمين من فضلكم اذكروا اسمكم الجميل ولقبكم والمؤسسة التي تعمل بها أولا إذا كانت هناك سؤال. أي سؤال أو المساهمة؟
Okay. Hocam ben elimi kaldırdım ama değerli hocalarımız başta size çok teşekkür ederim. Bu konferansta emeği geçen herkese büyükelçimiz başta olmak üzere rektörüm başta olmak üzere teşekkür ediyorum. Benim sorum Zekeriya hocamıza olacaktı. Ustaz Zekeriya entum tahaddestum an el müşkilet el mustalahat التي توجد في المصادر السودانية حقيقة أو على حسب رأيي لا يمكن أن نسميها مصادر سودانية بحتة إنما هي مأخوذة على الأكثر من المصادر الأجنبية خصوصا البريطانية منها لدي طلب ما هي المساهمة التي يمكن أن تساهم بالنسبة للمتلقي السوداني في تلقي المعلومة من المصادر التركية والمصادر الإنجليزية في نفس الوقت حتى تكون هناك يكون هناك نقد هل يمكن حمل مثل هذه المؤتمرات المفيدة إلى إلى إلى السودان مثلا شكرا جزيلا
شكرا جزيلا الإجابة أيضا موجودة من ضمن السؤال والسؤال جميل جدا أنا آسف أنا الآن متحرك ولكن سوف أقتصر بجوابي بإذن رئيس الجلسة المصطلحات طبعا هو مصطلحات مشكله جدا ليست بين تركيا والسودان فقط في كل البلدان الاسلاميه الان لان نحن اتجهنا الى استخدام المناهج العلميه في دراستنا تاريخ المناهج العلميه الغربيه والمناهج العلميه الغربيه ايضا يجبرنا على بعض الاصطلاحات ونحن لا نستطيع ان نبتعد عن هذه الاصطلاحات صحيح ان هناك بعض المبادرات سابقا بين تركيا والدول الاسلاميه لتصحيح الاخطاء الموجوده في الكتب الدراسيه ولكن هذه ايضا لا تكفي يجب علينا ايضا ان نقوم بالمؤتمرات او ندوات في هذا الموضوع ولكن اذا مسحنا بعض الاخطاء الموجودة في الكتب الدراسية ربما بعد مدة سوف يأتي الإدارة الثانية مثل ما صار في مصر وسيغيرها من جديد أهم شيء أن نغير المفاهيم في منهج التاريخ وطبعا لهذا الغرض يجب علينا أن نؤسس لقاءات وربما أيضا أنا اقترحت سابقا إلى مؤتمر الإسلامي تأسيس لجنة من علماء الاجتماعيين لإيجاد المصطلحات ليس في التاريخ فقط في العلوم الأخرى أيضا في كل العالم الإسلامي، لأن نحن كلنا نستخدم الكلمات أو المصطلحات الغربية، والصحيح يعني بعض الكلمات أو بعض المصطلحات مستعارة من الغرب طبعا لا بأس بها، لا نستغني عنها، ولكن ليست مطابق بتاريخنا. وشكرا.
شكرا جزيلا أستاذي الكريم. هل هناك أسئلة أخرى؟
تفضل طارق علي. أستاذ طارق علي.
Kabile sorunları hocalarım bize katılabiliriz. Selamun aleyküm ve size teşekkür ediyorum. İkinci fırsat bana verdiğiniz için tekrar teşekkür ediyorum. Birinci sorum da Arapça söyleyeceğim Zekeriya hocamıza. Alet tettefek ma'ya ustazuna enel müşkilatı nahnu nu'işuha hiye enana la nastati' ve la nastati' attahallus minha fi kafet muassasatina ilmiye ve inde ulemaina hiye غياب النظرة العلمية والمهنية وعدم الاهتمام بجهود الباحثين إن لم يكونوا يمثلون المؤسسة التي يديرونها، وبالتالي عدم استمرارية جهود المؤسسات. هذا لو سمحتم لي السؤال الأول لبروف زكريا. السؤال الثاني لأستاذي العزيز بروف سليمان كزلطوبرك. Is it not correct that Ottomanization in Red Sea and the ocean that came against the Balticals is more area than the Habashi state because the first one is Suleiman Reis and Hadim Suleiman Basha started in 1518, and the other one for the Habashi State or Habashi Administrative Act that is has been made by Özdemir Pasha and his son. The third question is, I think, Lee Al-Mutahadith, أيضاً تحدث باللغة العربية. فيما يخص هذين الاستجوابين الذين حصلا في الفترة العثمانية. هنالك فترة نشعر فيها بأن المعلومات في الدولة العثمانية المركزية أصبحت تقل، وكل واحد في الأرشيف العثماني يلاحظ ذلك. يعني إذا نظرت عن المعلومات في السودان في القرن السادس عشر والسابع عشر تجد الدفاتر مليئة حتى بالجوانب المالية والإدارية، لكن حينما تنظر في الفترة زي فترة المهدية تجد أن الدولة العثمانية اضطرت لاستجواب مثل هذين الشخصين للوصول إلى معلومات، لا سيما وأنها في ذلك الوقت لا زالت هي حاكمة لمصر. كنا لا نعتبر الحكم الإنجليزي السيطرة على مصر من ذلك الوقت، لأني أنا أريد أن أشير هنا إلى نقطة أن الإنجليز قد قفلوا مصر والسودان عن الدولة العثمانية رغم الجانب القانوني في أن هاتين المنطقتين لا زالت تابعة للدولة العثمانية، فأريد أن أخذ رأيكم حول ذلك. شكراً لهذه الأسئلة.
من فضلكم أستاذي زكريا.
نعم. إذا يعني إذا انقطعت الصوت أنا أعتذر. صحيح أنا أؤيد سعادتك لما تقول غياب المؤسسات العلمية حتى غياب المناهج العلمية تطابق مع تاريخنا. صحيح يعني يأتي بالمشاكل في هذا الموضوع، وأصلاً أنا كنت نويت أن أتحدث عن إمكانيات وحتى المشكلات في هذا الموضوع، ولكن الوقت ما كانت كافي، والآن نحن في بإمكاننا أن نبادر ونؤسس ولو مؤسسات بسيطة بين الدولتين أو بين الدول لكتابة إعادة كتابة تاريخ المنطقة والبنادق بأجمعها، لأن ليست الأفريقيا فقط، حتى تاريخ تركيا أيضا لها مشاكل فيها في هذا الموضوع. على سبيل المثال يعني كلمة حبشة مرت علينا كثير اليوم، وحضرتك كمان ذكرت الحبشة. أنا كلمة حبشة هو أصلا الإدارة تكون من مدينة جدة وسواكم ومصوع، ليست الإثيوبيا مثلا. هذه الكلمة أيضا غير موجودة، يعني مستخدمة في كتابات اللغة التركية. لما يستخدم حبشة يفكرون أفريقيا الشرقية بأجملها، بأكملها. معناها يعني نحن أيضا نحتاج لهذه المؤسسات والدراسات الجديدة. في الصبح ذكرى ما عملت من الأطروحات العلمية، تعرفون كل الأطروحات خاصة الدراسات العليا لا يعتبر يعني الدراسات عميقة، ولكن الدراسات أطروحات الدكتوراه مهمة جدا، ونحن نهتم ونوظف الشباب الأذكياء لأن يدرسوا هذه الأشياء بدعم المؤسسات اللي سوف نؤسس فيها. وشكرا.
شكرا جزيلا لكم أستاذي. أستاذ سليمان كزل توبراك، السؤال لكم. Sayın hocam, Süleyman hocam, soruyu alabildiniz mi? Süleyman hocam burada mısınız? Bir soru vardı Süleyman hocama ama Süleyman hocam bizi duymuyor sanırım.
Hocam herhalde Süleyman Bey'in biraz internetle ilgili problem var. Dolayısıyla düşmüş de olabilir.
Üstad Süleyman, هناك مشكلة لأستاذ سليمان بالإنترنت. مع الأسف لا يستطيع أن يجيب السؤال. We can take another only one more question at this point, if there is any. If there is not, we have come our we come to our time limit. We are out of time. And نعم لقد كانت هذه الجلسة جلسة مثمرة ومرضية للغاية. أعتقد أنها كانت مساهمة جيدة للغاية في الدراسات الأكاديمية والعلاقات بين البلدين والشعبين. أود أن أشكر منظمي الندوة والمحاضرين والمشاركين فيها. في هذه النقطة أنهي الجلسة الثانية. مع السلامة وشكرا جزيلا لكم.
Müsaadeniz olursa hocam ben de bir son bir teşekkürle kapatmış olayım programı.
Buyurun hocam.
Vaktimizi yapmış olduk. Güzel verimli bir programın sonuna gelmiş olduk. İstanbul Üniversitesi tarafından organize edilen tarihi derinlik içinde Türk Sudan İşgali Konferansı böylece tamamlamış olduk. İki oturumluydu zaten. Konferansın organize edilmesinde pek çok kişinin emeği geçti. Özellikle Hartum Büyükelçisi İrfan Deziroğlu Bey'e ve İstanbul Üniversitesi Rektörü Profesör Doktor Mahmut Akbaba'ya çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Bunun dışında konferansta sunumlarıyla katılan, bizlerle güzel bilgilerini paylaşan tüm panelistlere de teşekkür etmiş olalım. Ümit ediyoruz ki konferans Sudan üzerinde bölgedeki iyi gelişmeleri bir başlangıç teşkil edebilir. Bu anlamda başlangıçta yine bizleri ekranları başında takip eden tüm katılımcılara da uzaktan da olsalar teşekkür ediyoruz. Herkes sağlıkla kalsın. İyi günler diliyoruz. In English, we have completed conference on Turkish-Sudan relations in historical context organized by Istanbul University with this second and last session. On behalf of Istanbul University, I would like to thank all the participants who contributed to the conference by organizing or delivering their presentations, their papers. But I want to thank especially to Khartoum Ambassador of Turkey, Associate Professor İrfan Neziroğlu and Rector of Istanbul University, Professor Mahmut Ak. We hope that the conference will be a good start for positive developments in the region, especially in Sudan. And لقد أكملنا مؤتمر العلاقات التركية السودانية في السياق التاريخي الذي نظمته جامعة إسطنبول مع هذه الجلسة الثانية والأخيرة. نيابة عن جامعة إسطنبول أريد أن أشكر جميع المشاركين الذين ساهموا في المؤتمر من خلال تقديم أو تنظيم. بالخاصة أنا أريد أن أشكر سفير الجمهورية التركية الخرطوم ورئيس جامعة إسطنبول الأستاذ دكتور محمود. أتمنى أن يكون المؤتمر بداية جديدة للتطورات إيجابية في المنطقة وخاصة في السودان.